in a lot of our states by the Republican Party. Did the Russians do that? And when it comes to spreading false information, in this, what false information has played a bigger role in public opinion than this whole birther controversy over Obama? Did the Russians start that? I mean, come on. This idea that somehow the Russians had an influence in this election, I think is absurd. Second point. Now, we're going to hear a lot more with the investigations. The second thing was the New York Times report that at least they had sources in the FBI, anonymous sources, who said that there were intercepts of Trump supporters in contact with Russian embassy officials, whom the FBI considered intelligence officials. Now, certain things to say about that. One thing, if they had intercepts that involved any law breaking, that should have been reported immediately to the prosecutor's office, and if there was enough evidence, the prosecutor should have sought an indictment. Until then, the FBI is not supposed to be talking about ongoing investigations. Don't we have a presumption of innocence, first of all? And second, what is wrong with people talking to Russian embassy officials? I mean, one of the things that I tried when I was in the Soviet Union to get across to Gorbachev and to others is we were not interfering their elections when I dealt with Boris Yeltsin, which I did. And when they had elections coming up, we talked to everybody and they would come to us. We wanted to find out what their policies were. And I'm sure their security agents thought a lot of our diplomats were CIA, some were and a lot were not. Just like FBI will consider every Russian diplomat probably intelligence. Most of them are probably not, some of them will be. But the point is, if there was any evidence of legal, if these persons, I don't think they had clearances, so they probably weren't talking about classified information. If they were testing out ideas of things that could be done if they got to power, what's wrong with that? That's what we ought to be doing. So the idea that ipso facto, because there were telephone calls there, and then this is reported as if there is something nefarious about it. Now, I know there are going to be investigations and we'll find a lot more, and I'll have to say that the idea that these people that first of all denied that they had been talking to Russians and then turned out they were, this is a bit puzzling, except that I think that some of the Trump people know that the leaders of the Republican Party in Congress don't want any agreement with Russia, so they have been dicey about it. We'll learn more, but so far I can't see that Russia did anything wrong in this. And if there had been any law breaking, it should be prosecuted. Otherwise, why go out, you know, on a witch hunt? I was a lifelong Democrat until I became an independent when we started expanding NATO and so on. And I was a strong supporter of President Obama. But I'll tell you, I think if the Democratic Party keeps spending so much time trying to blame the Russians for what happened, they are going to fail to take advantage of what they can do in the next election to mend matters. That the Russians didn't deliver this election to Donald Trump. I mean, this is so clear, and to spend so much time on this, when actually it is in our vital interest to get better relations with Russia, and this shouldn't be seen as somehow irresponsible negotiations behind the scenes. So this is one of the things that I would point out. I could say more, but that's probably too much already.
Oh, never. So we've covered the past a little bit, we've covered the present, let's talk future, and then we'll open it up for questions from the audience. And that is, what would a good policy in the future look like? What would a real reset, maybe using the right Russian word this time, look like? Especially on a morning when we wake up to learn news about Syria, to hear that President Putin has already called this an act of violation of international law. Prime Minister Medvedev has said that that the cozy relations between the United States and Donald Trump lasted exactly 2.5 months as of today. Mm-hmm. And plus, in an environment where hacking, conspiracy theories, revelations of all kinds take place regularly, what would a good policy and a renewed good policy look like? And maybe, again, drawing on your own experience in the late 80s, early 90s, when you have written and said quite frequently, the United States and the Soviet Union enjoyed a good relationship. How would that look like now and in the future?
It's hard to be optimistic. Very hard to be optimistic. I'm one who feels that, for one thing, our policy in Syria has been mistaken from almost the word go. That goes back to about to around 2007, when, at least according to material in WikiLeaks, which did not come from the Russians in this case, indicates that we were trying in clandestine ways to remove Assad. Now, even for the last couple of years of the Bush administration. The problem with Syria is you're damned if you do, you're damned if you don't. There is no other possible leader of Syria who is going to be able to keep ISIS out and to keep them from having a center there right now, aside from Assad and his Alawite army. So you get rid of him, you're going to end up with Libya, but even worse in the sense because you've got ISIS controlling parts of both Iraq and Syria. One thing to remember. Second is the idea that Russia has no business there. You haven't looked at the map and you don't know much about history. But Russia has extreme important interests in that part of the world because most of the supporters of ISIS, many of them, come from the former Soviet Union and Russia itself. And once they come back, Russia is going to have tremendous problem of terrorism. It doesn't mean that anything they've done I can approve of or would approve of, but the idea they don't have any business here and should just let us take care of it, they say, look what happened in Iraq. We asked you not to go, as did the Germans and the French. You go there and you leave us all with a mess. Same thing in Libya. In this case, they let us defend Benghazi and we take it as license to take out Gaddafi. And we've got a mess and we've got the terrorists actually moving from Libya down into sort of Central Africa and creating problems there and establishing possible bases and so on. So, you know, they are reacting. Now, I don't know what they can do about this. I do think that if it is clear, and I have not seen the evidence, I don't know what who was actually responsible for the chemical weapons attack. If we know precisely that Assad ordered it and is responsible, then we should find a way this time really to take him out. I'm not sure we know that. And certainly even the first time, many of our intelligence people thought the evidence was ambiguous. And let's face it, sarin, almost any sophisticated terrorist organization can get hold of sarin. And the fight in Syria is so fratricidal, it has so many different parties, that unless you unusually have very clear evidence, you can't be sure who did it. So as horrible as the thing is, now simply striking, obviously you feel like you have to do something, but I don't know what we struck and how much, I haven't seen those details. But the thing is, it probably isn't going to deter it, because if whoever still has this gas can use it again. And given the politics and emotions of that period, these people are completely capable of using on their own people simply to draw retaliation against their enemies. This is something we have to understand. Now, I'm not privy to these classified information anymore. My friends who have been CIA analysts in that area, who are now retired, keep saying, and some of them writing publicly, that the evidence is still pretty ambiguous and it's very hard to be certain. So we are really in, I think, in the involvement in Syria, a very sort of damned if you do, damned if you don't situation. But the idea that we alone have any right to be there and taking care of it, when actually there are any number of other countries, Turkey, very much involved, our NATO ally, Saudi Arabia, very much involved, the most states. Of course, Iran is involved, and with their Hezbollah supporters, the ones they support in Lebanon. You have all of these regional forces with U.S. and Russia outside. Now, Russia has been cooperating with Iran to preserve the Assad regime, not because I think they want Assad to murder his own people, but because they don't see any other possibility of keeping the jihadists out, keeping ISIS out. That who is going to be able to unify Syria and lead it? And I think that their efforts to try to get a ceasefire were probably genuine. Now, at some faction, and again, without really good intelligence information, which we may not have, even those who have access to what we have, you can't really be sure who used those chemical weapons or why. There are so many different factions, each with different backers. And again, we've gotten ourselves in the middle of a terrible family fight in which there probably are going to be no winners. The losers are the people there. And one can only just feel that very strongly. But this constant escalation of military attempts to deal with it, I'm afraid, is not going to settle it. And I think it is most unfortunate that we haven't, from the very beginning, been cooperating with Russia to try to control that situation. And because if we both, Russia and we, were putting pressure on Assad to operate more humanely and to avoid the thing, that might have been successful. Our attempt overtly to remove him first, as ahead of anything else, really, I think, got us off on the wrong track. Because you remove him and you're going to end up with Libya. Except it's this time even worse, because there are more outside powers involved. And to put that first, I think, was a big mistake on our part. Everybody has made their share of them, and it's a tragic situation. And to the degree that it brings, I would say, even more feeling of controversy between Russia and the United States, that's a danger to all of us.
I was hoping that we could have a note of optimism, but I think it's possible today. Let me throw it open to the floor. We have maybe 25 minutes left, so I want to take at least a couple, three questions, try to recognize. Yep, it's you.
What are your thoughts on Russian involvement in Ukraine?
Russian involvement in Ukraine. Your thoughts and knowledge of it.
This is going to have to be a long answer. Just a few words about the history here. Ukraine, most of present-day Ukraine, had been actually part of Russia or the Russian Empire or the Soviet Union that was essentially led by Russians for over two centuries, for close to three centuries. The part that was newly added to Ukraine, and effectively just after World War II, was a part of Ukraine that had been in the Austro-Hungarian Empire, never in Russia. And then between the two world wars was part of Poland, part of Eastern Poland. And that's where much of traditional Ukrainian nationalism developed. Now, Stalin brought them and made them part of Ukraine, forced them in. They had a different dominant church. The Union Church was one of Orthodox ritual, but recognized the Pope. This happened with the Austro-Hungarian Empire and is a result of the Counter-Reformation. You can really get off on a lot of tangents when you talk about this. Bottom line is, when Ukraine went independent, it didn't fight for its independence. It went independent when the elected leader of Russia, Boris Yeltsin, wanted to depose Gorbachev, and therefore, in effect, took Russia and the others out of the Soviet Union. And they left the borders as they were. Ukraine from then on was deeply divided politically. In the mid-90s, I went there with a group that had worked in our National Security Council to talk to them about how you organize national security. And we gave them a few lectures on how we organized it in Washington. And then the Ukrainian spokesman got up and said, look, you people have been talking about foreign affairs. Here's our security problem. And he showed us an electoral map where half of the country in the West had voted one way, the other half had voted the other way. A country which did not have a federal constitution, but one where winner took all. In other words, if one side or the other won the presidential election, they nominated all the governors. Furthermore, the Ukrainian state took away what had been the political autonomy, local autonomy of Crimea, which was largely Russian, to some degree Crimean Tatar. They had been exiled by Stalin, but were coming back. But mainly Russian-speaking, with the largest and one of the most important Russian naval bases, one that had been defended from the British and French and then from the Germans. There was the Crimean War in the 19th century. There was in World War I and World War II. These were important battles. So you've got in Crimea an important Russian naval base. You have, now, when the Maidan revolt began, and this was a demonstration against the government when the president refused to sign an agreement with the EU. The assumption of the people was that that agreement with the EU would have solved many of their, not only economic difficulties, but would have, in effect, brought them into the EU, that they could become like a new Poland. There's no way it could have happened, because the demands that the EU was making in that, even today in the truncated government, they have not been able to put them in force. These people had real grievances, but that was not what was going to solve it. And when the Maidan revolt starting in 2014 went violent, the first violence was created in the West. When the Ukrainian nationalists began to take over the government buildings, which had been appointed by the very corrupt but elected president, Yanukovych. So the violence actually started in the West, not in the East. It was started by Ukrainian nationalists who had developed a number of militias that are direct descendants of the pro-Nazi militias that also the Germans had used before and during the war to operate against Poland, and were also committed a number of atrocities there. The descendants of Bandera, for example, and others. Now, as this was going on, then there was also there were not only the demonstrations in Kiev, but after Yanukovych fled the country and was replaced. This was the revolutionary government, immediately recognized by the United States, demonstrations directly involved by the Deputy Secretary of State, who was handing out cookies and cheering on the demonstrators and talking on the cell phone to our ambassador in Kiev about who should be prime minister. You speak about interference foreign elections. We had senior American officials trying to decide who's going to be the foreign minister of Ukraine. That's as if Chinese or Russians were trying to determine who was going to be the prime minister in Mexico. Would we put up with that? I don't think so. In other words, you know, people ignore a lot of these things. Now, then there was also the violence on all sides. In Odessa, which is also a Russian-speaking city, the port on the Black Sea, a group of Russians who were demonstrating in favor of the Russian language. One of the big issues, by the way, in Ukraine was the people in the West wanted to make Ukrainian the only official language. Well, 44% of the Ukrainians actually preferred to speak Russian, and particularly those in Eastern, instead of just recognizing that you can have both languages. It was as if the Irish would say you can't be a good Irishman if you speak English, you've got to speak Celtic. So this was an issue. These people were demonstrating for the Russian language. I think over 40, I forget the exact number, took refuge in what had been a trade union building. That building was set on fire and all of them burned. And it was this demonstration that Putin said, we've got to save the Russian speakers in the east, and we've got to save our naval base in Crimea. So, yes, he sent in the little green men, and they held a referendum. They held one. Over 90% voted to go to Russia. Well, that, of course, you can't take too seriously, but by all evidence, at least 60% or more of the people in Crimea actually preferred to be in Russia. They were Russian speaking, and Ukraine had not really done much for Russia, and they had removed repeatedly any autonomy which Crimea had had earlier. So you did have a Russian takeover, but it was done peacefully. They said, you know, look, in Kosovo later, you bombed Serbia, you killed hundreds of people, you destroyed a lot of territory, and then you broke the rule that we had agreed to at Helsinki back in 1975, that there should be no change of territory, that is not mutually agreed. We recognize Kosovo's independence as a result of an illegal war against Serbia in their eyes, and that they peacefully took territory that was rightfully Russian, that most of the people wanted to be in Russia without any loss of blood. And why are we getting so upset over that? Well, it was illegal the way it was done. There was no reason for us to recognize it legally. But the point is that it was, I think, given the circumstances, it was an overreaction on our part, because I'm absolutely sure that Putin would not have tried to take Crimea if he had had assurances from Obama that under no circumstances are we going to try to take Ukraine and whatever government it has into NATO. If he could have given and was willing to give credible assurances, which apparently we were not willing to do. The argument is, don't they have the freedom to ask to be a member of NATO? And the answer to that is, of course they have the freedom to ask it. But that doesn't mean they get it automatically. You have to consider where it's in your interest or not, if you're the one that are making the decisions about NATO. So much of the public argument, I think, just simply misses the point. The Donbass is an entirely separate question. I don't think that Putin ever intended to bring that part in Russia, but you did have what was potentially a separatist unit there, and he definitely did give them military support, feeling that he couldn't let the pro-Western Ukrainian government settle this by military force. So basically, we have a real mess, and our sanctions over these things are not producing any useful results, except making it more difficult for, I would say, the middle class Russians to become part of the world economy and to develop enough confidence to develop more democratic procedures at home. So we're hurting the very Russians that we need if we want a democratic Russia in the future. So the problem is now, it's a dilemma, and just like the question of Syria, how do you get out of this? And again, I don't see any way other than a declaration of, I would say, both our presidents, look, there's really no reason for us to be enemies. Why can't we meet and try to find a way of separating what is really important from what is not? And frankly, we're going to have to concede to the Russians the same, I would say, area of influence around them, and particularly in the former Soviet Union, that we have exercised since the Monroe Doctrine in the Western Hemisphere. Russia will never accept moving the NATO military alliance into any areas other than the three Baltic states, they know they're special, into what had once been the Soviet Union. That's simply a very basic red line. And until we are convinced that, you know, to ourselves that we have to deal with it, it's going to be hard to settle it.
Good questions require good long answers. Let's take another. Bob, Kirsten.
Yeah, so it's become, I think, a kind of an article of faith, a statement of fact in the American mainstream media that Russia is aggressive, has been aggressive, and so there's a Russian threat toward the Baltic states and Poland. There's even an imminent threat of Russian invasion of the Baltic states. And I've read various analyses, Stephen Kotkin from Princeton, for example, about how Russia has traditionally been an expansionist power, that even the idea that this is somehow genetically in the Russian DNA at this point. I'm wondering if you think there's any particular Russian threat to the Baltic states. What would be gained for Russia by invading the Baltic, for example? What should American policy now be toward the Baltic and Poland and NATO in that area?
Well, the three Baltic countries are now members of NATO. And if there should be aggression against them, Article 5 of the NATO Treaty says that an attack on one is considered an attack on all, and that the governments will consult as to what to be done in response. It doesn't say that it's automatically war. I don't think that Russia is threatening the Baltic states militarily. And I think that actually the issues of bringing missile defense into Eastern Europe, which we had no good reason to do and which they have opposed, plus a very intensive intelligence collection campaign around their borders, particularly around Kaliningrad, has led them to do these quite irresponsible military flights out in the Baltic area. It certainly is offending Finland and Sweden. But the fact is, I think they're not going to invade Estonia or Latvia or Lithuania. What would they gain from that? Absolutely nothing. I do think that our buildup, which really does violate one of the agreements we made in the Russia-UN, in the Russia-NATO agreement, when we said we would not permanently station foreign forces in Eastern Europe. Now, we say they're not permanently stationed, but we'll simply rotate them, so in effect you have a virtual permanent station. And that simply, how are they going to react? They're going to react by bringing more nuclear weapons into Kaliningrad. They're going to react probably by beginning to violate the INF Treaty. How do we react? Do we go back into another nuclear arms race? Or do we remember the most important fundamental agreement that Gorbachev and Reagan made in their first meeting. It is a nuclear war cannot be won, must never be fought, and therefore there can be no war between us. And for at least a decade, we acted according to that. Now, you know, with the expansion of NATO, with the movement on both sides of the military, it's as if war is possible, or we have to use military means to contain Russia. And I think that's the wrong go, and that's the reason I compare it to the First World War. I think that it is stupid to get into this sort of thing. They are not militarily threatening the Baltic states. You know, there is an area in Estonia right next to Russia, which is largely Russian populated. And there are issues there because the Estonians and the Latvians refuse to give most of the Russian-speaking population citizenship when they went independent. Now, that's also a very complicated history. But the fact is, Russia would gain nothing from trying to control this territory. And as I said, the idea that what they did in Ukraine, which I've gone at much great length to try to explain, really had nothing to do with what they would do in the Baltic states. The idea that people often hear that Putin is out to reestablish the Soviet Union is absurd. I don't know what's in his mind, though he has said anybody that does not regret the collapse of the Soviet Union has no heart. Anybody who wants to reconstitute it has no brain. And he's also explained the reason he considers the collapse of the Soviet Union a catastrophe is it because it left so many Russians outside their own country. Okay, but does that mean he wants to reestablish it? I don't think so, but even if it does, he can't do it. There's no way Russia is going to be able to reestablish that empire. And if by sometimes they were succeeded in some cases, they would have more problems at home than abroad. Because there's nothing that weakens a country more than trying to rule people that don't want to be ruled by you. The idea that expanding your influence by or control by military brings about greater power, greater influence is absurd. What did we gain from invading Iraq? Well, we lost nearly 4,000 American lives. They lost probably 100,000, most of them killed by their own people, to be sure. We're in for more than $1 trillion in debt. And we created conditions which ISIS came when there had been no Al-Qaeda there before. I mean, trying to deal with these things by military means backfires. And they'll backfire on Russia too. And why the dickens should we get in the middle of it? Now, when it comes to, yes, if Russia should invade any of the Baltic states, yes, we do.